coming before the throne of grace this morning in prayer today. We have some very honored guests with us today, so as you pray, pray for them. Pray for their ministry as they minister to us today. Robert Johnesse is with us today. Friends of Israel, so glad to have them. Father in heaven, it's so good to be in your house today. It's so good to sing these great hymns of the faith, to be reminded of what we have in Jesus Christ, that our sins have been forgiven. We have been delivered from the condemnation of our sin when we come to know you as our Lord and Savior. And Father, we do pray, Father, today that should there be any in our midst today, that the Spirit of the living God would quicken their heart, they would be made aware of the fact of their great need of Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. We do pray for our brothers that comes to share with us in a few moments today. We ask, Father God, that you would just anoint his lips from on high, that he could have great liberty, great freedom, great clarity of mind. That there might be the unction of the Holy Spirit upon the teaching and preaching of the word that we might receive it today. The Holy Spirit might have liberty to teach our hearts, convict us, show us the things that we need to be taught and learned, the things that we need to do to make right in our own lives, that we might be more Christ-like in our daily walk with you. Father, we do pray. Thank you for the music ministry. We thank you for our musicians as they prepare and for all the work that they do and put in just to make this day work the way it works. We just appreciate it so much. We thank the men that work in the sound booth and the Sunday schools program, Father, the nursery workers. We just appreciate the people who use their abilities, their talents, their gifts to serve you, Father, that we might be in a place and position where we work for you and preach. Father, we do pray today that as the word goes forth and speaks to us. We pray for our country today. Our country has a tremendous need today, God, and a need that it would turn to you and look to you. Pray for our leaders today that they would be mindful that they need Christ as their Lord and as their Savior. Father, for the wicked agenda that is on the table, we would pray, Father, that that agenda would never become a reality in this great nation. We pray, Father, for the church across this nation, that the word would be proclaimed today, and our missionaries would have liberty and protection to watch over them as the minister in a variety of places around the world today. Bless the word, we pray today. In the shades of night, we'll pull upon this day that many have had it. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. In the way of announcements this morning, you read your bulletin, I know you've read the bulletin. How do I know you've read the bulletin? I don't. Sometimes you call me up and say, well, what am I going to do? It's in your bulletin. Read it. But just to help you along the way, reading it, we do have an elders meeting tonight after the evening service. And next Sunday, we plan on having a baby dedication. I know one baby that we're going to have to dedicate. Maybe there's some others. I don't think so. You know, I have a little grandson, Brother Robert, a little grandson. And little Adam, he's back there someplace, isn't he? And he's behaving, isn't he? Just like his daddy. I trained him well. But we're looking forward to that. VBS meeting next Sunday as well. For those of you who plan to be in Bible school and help out in that ministry, we look forward to that. Coming up in July, it's in your bulletin, 12th and 16th. And we need workers. And so we're going to have that meeting next Sunday right after the morning service. We'll be talking about that. Read your bulletin, be informed. Tonight we're going to continue the study that we've been studying in, the steadfast faith in the hour of persecution. And tonight I titled the message, The Church in a Toxic Culture. We are in a very, very toxic culture. If you don't believe that, just turn on your TV and listen to what's said. If you listen, been to Sunday school this morning, heard a brother teach this morning. He shared just a number of things that can cross over. He's teaching about Israel, but can certainly cross over to those of us who love the nation of Israel, preach and teach about the nation of Israel, and hold to the Judeo-Christian values that you and I hold to as believers in Jesus Christ. The world that we live in finds us that we need to be reprogrammed. At least that's what they think. But I think they're the ones that need to be reprogrammed. Don't you? I know how to get it done, don't you? They just come to the Lord and they will take care of all their agenda that they have on there. But encourage you to be back here tonight. Services start at 7 o'clock, a little inspiration time, testimony time, praising the Lord, worshiping the Lord. And then we'll spend some time in the Word tonight. I believe that's all the announcements. Are there any other announcements from the floor? Good to have my good friend Clifford Mann back there. Haven't seen him. Brother Robert, he and I worked together for a long, long time. I tell you, he's a piece of work. Part of the reason is he's from Michigan. But we still love him. We try real hard. Good to have you, Brother Clifford, with us today. He's had shoulder surgery and shoulder replaced. Said he wore out the socket. I can't believe it never did anything to wear it out. That's what he says. This is just beat up on Clifford Sunday, so you came the right time, the right place. Good to have you today, Brother Clifford. And any other visitors we have here this morning? Good to have you. Do we have any anniversaries this morning?
Thank you. I'd like to dedicate this song this morning to Pastor Mike on his birthday. But this song was also aimed at, this song was also meant for missionaries and Sunday school teachers. So this morning, if you're a Sunday school teacher and you haven't seen the results of your lessons and you haven't seen things here on earth, this song was written many years ago by Ray Bolts. And it talks about when he went to heaven, he was met by a man that was one of his students long ago in Sunday school and what it meant to him. So as if you're a Sunday school teacher this morning, keep on keeping on. Don't get discouraged, because one day we're going to meet the Lord in the air and he's going to show us all the rewards that we have in heaven.
My child, look around you. Great is your
Steve. Appreciate that so much. Junior Church, you are dismissed. Pray for your Junior Church and Junior Church workers as they go. At this time, Brother Robert Johnesse, this pulpit is yours. Let us have it. But the Lord has laid upon your heart, brother. Appreciate it.
And, Shalom, Pastor. Thank you. And thank you, Brother Steve, for that, those kind words this morning as well, and song, ministering song to all of us. And I'm going to try to get my technology going here, so give me a minute. And it was working fine this morning, so let's see if it's working now. You know that we have some books on the back table there and a magazine as well, and it is free for 1 year, called Israel My Glory. If you'd like to get one, they're free today as well. All the books on the table are $10 today, and so we wanted to bring that along for you with the message of what was happening today, right? Obviously, I represent an organization called the Friends of Israel Gospel Ministry, and I am a friend of Israel, and I stand with Israel during these very difficult times. The Apostle Paul told young Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3 that in last days perilous times will come. Well, in Israel right now, they're not only perilous, they are truly violent times as well. And I wanted to share about what is happening from my heart, because I love the Jewish people and I stand for Israel. I love the Torah, the writings and the prophets, and I teach from them as well as I will this morning in Genesis chapter 12. I believe that the Jewish people are God's chosen people, and that they have a right to exist and live in peace and safety in their promised land. I was sharing with the Sunday school class this morning that not everyone feels that way. And even in the history of the Old Testament, in the book of Esther, you had example of a man named Haman. And we studied Esther chapter 3 to find out his heart. And the heart of Haman was a heart full of hate against God's chosen people living in their promised land. And I use that to bring us to a modern day application as well, that involve what is happening in Israel and against Israel and against Israel's citizens as well. Because the heart of Haman, I believe, is in the heart of Iran, is in the heart of Hamas, is in the heart of Islamic Jihad. heart of Iran, the heart of Hamas, and the heart of Islamic Jihad is full of hate towards the Jewish people, and as you can see, trying to commit genocide towards the Jewish people as well. Where does all this come from, you might say, from these groups? Well, in Iran, you will find this man who is in charge of the Aerospace Force and Missile Unit Commander, Hajizida, when he said on May 13th of this year, and I quote, "All the missile might you see in Gaza was created with Iran's support, and this effort was continued around the clock for years." The heart of hate of Iran. And one of the things that Iran has improved with their hate is the Fajr 5 rocket that has been used most recently in this particular battle. Tuesday of this last week, we seen many of these rockets, now over some 2,500 as of account today. And quite obviously, their life is quite different than our life here in the United States of America. And one of the things that their life includes on a daily basis is a red alert siren that warns them and gives them 13 seconds to get into a bomb shelter or a safe place. And this will give you an idea just what happens in the lives of the families of Jewish people and their wives and husbands and children and grandchildren as well. When this red siren goes off, my understanding is it takes about 13 seconds before the rocket hits. And one of the good things, of course, has been the Iron Dome system, which has provided a great defense. The Iron Dome system is a defensive system, not an offensive system. And it's being used to protect the citizens in Israel, whether they be Jew or Arab or some other nationality. But many of them, sadly to say, have died as a result of these attacks. And these are some of them. And I drawn, of course, closely to the young boy that you see there down here in the left corner. And this is, the rocket is a result of this picture as well. And I'll explain this as you take a look at the picture. Hebrew media is reporting that these two women killed in a rocket attacks on Ashkelon were killed in two separate locations. One was an elderly woman who was sitting in her home. Several relatives were wounded as well. The second was a foreign caregiver of an elderly woman. The two did not manage to get to shelter in time. It's very difficult for the elderly to quickly get to shelter during this time as well. As you can see in that picture, it truly destroyed her home at this well. And as I think about what's happening, I think about how this should not be in our world today. It happened in the world of Haman, where he literally paid mercenaries to try to murder all the Jewish people in the lands. And here we're seeing that same hate. And for me, I look at the Jewish people, the nation of Israel, in a different way as an evangelical Christian. than they do. I look at it from the scriptures, and you'll see here the verse of scripture that I want to use this morning to point out to you some very important things about the Jewish people, the nation of Israel. And it goes back into the Hebrew Bible and Bereshit, or Genesis chapter 12, and verses 2 and 3, as you see on the screen. I've taught on this passage of scripture many times. Theologians call it the Abrahamic covenant. And there are two different types of covenant that you find in the Bible, whether it's an Old Testament or New Testament, whether it's the Hebrew Bible or the Greek Bible, but it's both unconditional and conditional covenants. And I want to explain that to you by just using an example of everyday life for all of us. A conditional covenant is like when we went to the bank and wanted to buy a home and borrowed the money, called a mortgage, and they made you sign all these papers, right? And they said, we'll lend you this much money, in other words, if you'll pay us back this much money. And of course, it ends up being a whole lot more than what the house costs at the beginning, right? But that is a conditional covenant. There's conditions tied to it. They will give you this money if you will give them this money back. Now, an unconditional covenant is quite opposite of that, because this, using the bank analogy, if you went to the bank, of course, and borrowed the money to buy the house, and they looked at you and said, you don't have to pay any of this back. After you pulled yourself up off the floor, right? All right. You probably look at your wife or your spouse and says, let's get out of here before they change their mind, right? And there's no conditions tied to that money whatsoever. That is unconditional in its nature. And what we have here, when God spoke to Abram to get out of the land and the life which he was in, of course, and to leave that, his family and his traditions there and his lifestyle there, and go to a totally different land that God was promising him. Now, he didn't even know where it was at that particular point, right? But by faith, Abraham, now keep that phrase in mind, by faith, Abraham packed up everything and took off. And it was interesting that as he talked to him about this great move in life, he explained and promised to him certain things that would go along with this move. Now, Abram was just one man, chosen by God. And as he chose him, God unconditionally promised to him certain things. And as you see there on the screen, one of the first things that we see, as far as God was concerned, is that he was going to make you a great nation. God was going to give this man a nation. Not just any nation, but a great nation, Gadol, a great nation. And here is one man, chosen by God. Out of faith, Abraham responded, and God says, I'm going to give you and make you a great nation. Now, there are a lot of nations on the planet at that time, a lot of people on the planet. But this is one nation that God promised unconditionally to give. And you say, well, how do you know it's unconditional? He says, I will do this. God says, I will do this. what's interesting as we go along is not only is he going to give him unconditionally a great nation, but he says as well, I will bless you. And the word blessing here is a unique word. But as I studied it carefully, I realized that God was not only promising a nation here through Abraham and his lineage, but he was promising to favor that nation as well. In other words, he just wasn't going to leave it all alone. He was going to favor that nation. Now, that's a great promise to give to a particular nation on this planet. And yet, that's how God was dealing with Abraham and this nation. And by the way, that nation today is called Israel. And God is favoring that nation today as well, because of the unconditional covenant. Now, you see where I'm going here in interpreting this passage in Genesis to application for my understanding and how I look at the Jewish people, the nation of Israel today. It's not an arbitrary thing for me. I look at what God says about it, and I believe it, and I ingest it into my personal beliefs and worldview that this is a favored nation. And on top of that, he goes on and says, and make your name great, giving him a divine name. Now, don't you find it interesting that even today, the name of Abraham and the story of Abraham is claimed by Christianity, is claimed by Judaism, and is claimed by Islam as well, right? I mean, here's a man that nothing particular about him until God favored him. And God had made an unconditional covenant with him. And now his name exists throughout time until 2021, and is still very precious. It's precious to me as an evangelical Christian because I realize that the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is my God as well, you see, as a New Testament Christian. And so I embrace that name as something that is part of my theology as well. I embrace that nation. I embrace that favor. And of course, we also see here, and you shall be a blessing. God is giving the world a divine gift through the Jewish people, the nation of Israel. They're a gift to us. They're a gift in many ways. There are physical gifts, of course. I mean, technology gifts. I mean, you have a cell phone today. Cell phones were created in Israel. And most Americans, even this morning, they're carrying them, right? In the area of medicine, in the area of economics as well, we find them a blessing to our world in many ways. I mentioned the Iron Dome system this morning. That is a blessing in the area of military because we have the same type of system. And it was truly researched and developed in Israel. And we have that defensive weapon for our military as well. So there's many blessings that we can see here, and God is bringing those blessings through the Jewish people and through the nation of Israel to us as well. And then, of course, course, there is some phraseology here next that I find very interesting, because up to this point, God is making an unconditional covenant with Abraham and his descendants, the Jews. But now we're going to see that that unconditional covenant ties all of us to it as well. In other words, you'll notice in this verse now that God says, I will bless those who bless you, in other words. And this is applied to all Gentiles throughout time. And as an evangelical Christian, I realize that my life and my choices and my words in reference to the Jewish people, the nation of Israel, God is going to bless as I support them, as I stand with them as well. And so I wanted to point that out, that this was for the rest of us, not for the Jewish people. And this is applied to our lives even today as evangelical Christians. Now, I find very few evangelical Christians who aren't trying to bless the Jewish people, because they love them as well, and I know many of you feel the same way. And my wife and I have committed ourselves for the rest of our lives to be a blessing to the Jewish people, whether it's in Cincinnati, where we live, or whether it's in Rehovot, Israel, that I go and volunteer at Kaplan Medical Center as well. And I'm motivated to be a blessing to them because I realize that God is going to be a blessing to me and my life. I find this in a singular way. I will bless those who bless you, specifically the Jewish people here. And so I wanted to point that out to you this morning, that an application is a great blessing that goes along with this Abrahamic covenant for Gentiles and not just for Jewish people. Now, there are those who totally interpret this differently, and of course, they are part of the next part of this verse, and I will curse him who curses you. In other words, there's not only a divine blessing, but there's a divine curse as well here. And obviously, God knew that as this nation began, as his favor fell upon them, as his name, their name became great, that there were going to be those who rebelled against them. And may you understand that to me, that's what's happening in reference to Iran, Islamic Jihad, and also Hezbollah, and the other enemies that Israel has in the area. In their heart, they want to be a curse to the Jewish people and to the nation of Israel. And how strong could a curse be than indiscriminate rockets flying in to your country and landing anywhere and everywhere among your innocent citizens and killing some of them? They have truly a method of cursing that is violent, and that's what's happening in Israel today. And not only, you see in my mind here as I look at this, not only are they rebelling and hating Israel and the Jewish people that are living there, but technically they are going back and hating and rebelling against the God who made this blessing and this curse, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So as I apply that and think about that, every missile that flies towards Israel is a missile in the face of God. God was the original Zionist here in this passage of Scripture. And they want to wipe God's covenant plan, the Jewish people and the nation and the land, off the face of the earth, don't they? And so, this is my worldview here. And in this as well, you'll find one more thing that I wanted to point out to you this morning, and that is the divine effect, where he says that in you, all right, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Now, once again, we find a message of blessing through the Jewish people. Okay. And I mentioned earlier some medical blessings, some technological blessings as well, some of the great minds of science were Jewish, but there is also an interesting verse in the New Testament in Galatians chapter 3 and verse 8, where the Apostle Paul points out that our very message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, it is tied to Genesis 12:3 and this phrase, that there is some spiritual blessings that are received because of this phrase as well. And Paul quotes that, all right? And he quotes it here, all families of the earth shall be blessed. Within the context, I believe, as I interpret it, in reference to Jesus and reference to salvation, in reference to the gospel. And the faith of Abraham was significant in all of this. Not his works, but his faith. And so we find truly here that as evangelical Christians, I'm thankful for the blessing, the spiritual blessings that came through Jesus, who is my Savior and my Lord. And I'm thankful for the spiritual blessings of the Holy Scriptures. And thankful to the Jewish men who wrote down these Holy Scriptures to give me the truth that applied clearly, not only in their time, but to my world today and what is happening in my world today. And I know Pastor Mike is going to apply these scriptures to the church tonight in his message, he told me. And so we have these blessings that come to all through the Jewish people, and I'm thankful and grateful for that today. The prophet Zechariah said something very interesting here. All right, in Zechariah chapter 2 and in verse 8. He who touches Israel touches the apple of my eye. God still has a loving, caring, graceful relationship with the Jewish people, the nation of Israel today. And you don't even want to touch them wrongly in any way, shape, or form. And so, I looked at this cartoon and I thought to myself, you ought to show this and help them to understand, all right, God's love for the Jewish people and God's fulfillment of these promises that we just read. In Psalm 121 and verse 4, behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. If you're going to go up against Israel, you've got to go up against God. And if you're going to curse Israel, God is going to curse you as well. And as I look at all the violence that is there, I truly believe that that violence is the heart of Haman, exhibited in Iran, the terrorist group Hamas and Islamic Jihad and Hezbollah. And don't be surprised if we start seeing rockets from the north from Hezbollah next. And there's some that already have come their way. And who gave them this nation? Who gave them this land? It was God himself, was it not? And in Genesis chapter 15 and verse 18, we find a story here, once again with Abraham. And God promises not only the nation and the land, the promised land, but he also gave us, all right, the dimensions, the territorial boundaries of it. And you'll notice in that verse, verse 18, in the same day the Lord made a covenant with Abraham. This is the blood sacrifice, the blood confirmation of the covenant words that were given, saying, unto thy seed have I given this land, from the river of Egypt unto the great river, the river Euphrates. Now, obviously, throughout time, that piece of property has been battled over for years. And it has a great history of that as well. Let me just point out to you from 1947 to 1949. In 1947, the petition that was given by the UN, you'll see here the Arab state and the Jewish state on this map on the left. And then, of course, in the 1949 partition on the right, you'll see there's much more that is given. But this is small compared to the promise that God gave in Genesis chapter 15 that we just read in verse 18. If we take those words to be true and literal, which I do, the territory would look like this. And the territorial boundaries would be much larger than what they are at this particular time. So, if there's a land dispute that is happening, then the land dispute, quite obviously, is with God and what he recorded in Genesis chapter 15 in reference to the boundaries there at that time. And you'll notice here, and just looking at this map right here, it goes down here into Egypt, across here, northern part of Saudi Arabia, and over here to the Ur of the Chaldees, which is, of course, over here in Babylon, or Iraq and Babylon, and up into Syria, and over into Lebanon, and then down here along the coast as well, and even includes Gaza. So if you're fighting over the land, you're fighting against God who gave the land. And so I realize that that issue is going to continue until Messiah comes, I believe Jesus is that Messiah, and at his second coming will restore that land and complete as promised in Genesis 15 and verse 18. And so this gives us, as far as an application today, right now, understanding that there is no land dispute. All the land belongs to them according to God. Okay? And there's always land disputes, and there's always who owns this and who owns that exists over there and will continue to exist. And I find it interesting that they fight over a piece of property or a piece of land that has been given to the Jewish people, and yet the Arab people and the Muslims, they have their land. And their land is much larger, of course, than all of what Israel has. And surrounding them is their land as well. And so I wanted to point that out to you in closing today. That the land issue, I understand, is very real, but it belongs to the Jewish people, according to God. And that truth and that covenant is what I believe and what I stand for. And so I want you to continue to hold on to those very important teachings from the Old Testament here, in reference to God's chosen people and the promised land. Because the hate will continue from Hamas, Iran, Islamic Jihad. And I just heard this morning that $9 billion is given by Iran to Hamas to buy more rockets, to get more rockets. Does that hate continue? It is continuing. And the rockets continue because of that hate. So love the Jewish people. Love the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Love the blessings that are ours through the Jewish people as they go through all of this. And above all, pray for peace in Jerusalem. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so very much for the opportunity to be here this morning in worship together. We thank you for the Holy Scriptures that we read this morning, a blessing of Jewish writers to our lives and to guide us in our thoughts and in our hearts and how we should feel towards the Jewish people. And Lord, you truly are the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who God who loves the world and gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And Lord, we want to thank you for all these blessings and all this love that is shown down from you unto our lives and to the lives of the Jews in Israel as well. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Tremendous teaching, something that we all need to be reminded of and hear often. Our hearts and our lives are truly indebted to the nation of Israel, and particularly the person Jesus Christ, who came to die on the cross for our sins. For God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son. Aren't you thankful for that today? We're so thankful to have this missionary couple with us this morning. Before we close, we always close with an invitation. You never know how the Lord's going to move hearts and men and women. Perhaps God has spoke to your heart today. But I trust that as you make your way out the door, you pass by the table in the back, leave your offering, you're told you to pray about this, pray about your offering, support this fellow who work in the community's ministry. There's a basket there, this mark for the Robert and Heidi Johnesse, Friends of Israel Ministry. Let's take our hymnal this morning and turn to page 387. Let's all stand and sing this verse, just as I am.
Thank you.